So welcome all for my presentation on computer interfaced experiments using an open source tools. So these are the outline of my presentation, introduction about the ICT tool and the pedagogy. So I'm just giving an information about ICT tools and the basic measurements which can be done with ICT tools, like such as XSPICE hardware and the tracker software and the Scilab simulation. And some of the applications in engineering using these tools, I'm also going to demonstrate with sample experiments, and finally the conclusions. So it is generally agreed that development could only be meaningful if and when it is science and technology driven. So information communication technology in education is the mode of education that uses information and communications technology to support, enhance and optimize the delivery of information. Worldwide research has shown that ICT can lead to an improved student learning and better teaching methods. So what are the importance of ICT in education? Students can able to get means a promoting students' intellectual qualities through higher order thinking, a problem solving and deep understanding of the concepts. So by this method, effective interacting teaching or learning environment is created. It is a learner centered and activity oriented approach. So this can also improve the quality of instruction. So let us come back to the scenario where we are today. This picture depicts our science by engineering education system. The theory and the experiments are not going in hand by hand. So why the experiments are ignored in our science or engineering education system? Is it because of exam oriented evaluation system, or lack of interest by the students, or lack of equipment or the facility? Then what methodology, what teaching methodology we need to follow? So the traditional method of teaching science or engineering, which is teacher centered, so this method only present passive learners. So in this method, so learners are mere spectators listening and swallowing all that comes from teachers. So that alternative teaching method is the ICT enabled method. So in this, the role of ICT in two models of science curriculum are considered here. One is based on empirical science, another is model of scientific reasoning. So what benefit you are going to get from visualization of the physical parameters? So it helps us to understand the learning concepts better. It helps us to get a real time data, immediate feedback of the response. These are the sample photographs. And flexibility. Flexibility means we can able to change the physical parameters frequently. So by doing all these graphical and numerical analysis, we can able to understand the concepts better. So we are all using these conventional equipments in our laboratory. So what are the drawbacks of these conventional equipments? So here, these operators are not programmable. So we cannot do automation here. So we cannot interface these experiments, means these operators to a computer. Then how do you overcome this problem? Here we are using the open source hardware as well as the open source software framework, that is a XSPICE 17 hardware device. XSPICE 17 means experiments for young science engineers and scientists. This is developed by Inter University Accelerator Center, New Delhi, by Dr. Ajit Kumar. What are the features of this hardware? So it works as a oscilloscope, 4-channel oscilloscope. It works as a function generator. It works as a programmable voltage source, means this PV1 and PV2 are power source, DC power source, and they are AC power source. And also it supports 12C standard sensors. So the main thing is it's giving a 12-bit analog resolution. This hardware is controlled by a software written in Python, and also it can be controlled by C programming. So with this XSPICE hardware, we are going to do some of the experiments related to electronics, electrical, physics and mechanical experiments. So here a Python code which is written, it is controlled the XSPICE device, and also we can embed mathematical equations to the hardware so that can be visualized on the screen. So before going to sample experiments, I wanted to give the information about hardware. So here PV1, PV2 are programmable voltage 1, means programmable voltage 2, that gives plus or minus 5 volts and plus or minus 3.3 volts here, since this is connected to a USB to a computer, so that is powered with a 5 volt input supply here. So here SQ1, SQ2 are square wave generators. It gives AC signal. OD1 is digital output 1. So either you can get 0 or 5 volt. Here WG is the waveform generator. So it is the AC source. Here this is the source portion and this is the measurement portion. All these black terminals are ground. Here IN1 and IN2 are inputs. In IN1 we can able to measure the capacitance. In IN2 we can able to measure the frequency. In sensor we can able to measure the resistance. A1, A2, A3 are the voltmeters. It acts as voltmeters and also it measures the frequency. We can also connect an external mic to it. So here RG is the feedback resistance to enhance the output. So this will support the 12C standard sensors. So let me open the hardware. So here the actual hardware I'm showing in front of you. So let me connect one wire from WG, that is the waveform generator that gives an AC signal. So whatever the frequency it is giving, that I'm measuring at A1. So let me open the software framework. So you can see that, see, if I enable A1, I'm able to see the AC signal. So here the right hand side portion is the controlling panel and here left hand side is the display. Here it is a 4 channel oscilloscope. So I can able to change the frequency here through a sliding bar, and also I can input the value here. So not only the sine wave, so we can also get square wave and rectangular waves also. I can change the amplitude also here. So I can able to make a measurement of DC power supply here, and I can able to make resistance measurement and as well as the capacitance and the frequency measurement. So time base also can be increased here, increase or decrease to a desired value. So here there are list of experiments which are already preloaded. So they are written in Python codes. So these are the preloaded experiments for the basic school level experiments, and these are the electronics experiments for graduate and the undergraduate level. These are the experiments related to electrical, sounds, mechanical. So there are other experiments. This hardware also works as a data logger, and also it supports 12C standard sensors. So here with this hardware, people have done a lot of good work. So for example, they have made automated weather monitoring system. So not only the graphical user interface, here we can give your own Python code that can be plugged it here and that can be visualized. So these are the Python code. So here we can write our own Python code that can be executed. So let me choose the oscilloscope mode. I wanted to show you one thing here. For example, I have connected WG. Since I disconnected WG and I'm connecting one more wire to A1, so that is the measurement point. So I'm holding the wire, other end of the WG wire. Now I'm holding the other end of the A1 wire. What will happen? It shows that how the human body is conducted. This is how a simple experiment can be demonstrated to a school level students. Now I'm going to give a brief information about some of the sample experiments. So these experiments I'm not going to demonstrate it. So it is a experiment which is related to sound waves. So here what I've done here, I've connected two piezo buzzers to a frequency generators SQ1 and SQ2. So that is giving the frequency. Based on this frequency, it is generating a sound. So those two waves, sound waves, are interfering. So that interference pattern are recorded with the help of microphone here. So that interference pattern is recorded on the microphone and it is displayed here. So if you do the Fourier analysis for each individual frequencies, you can able to get the peaks. Now let me come back to the digital electronics experiments. So in our regular labs, we are going to verify the truth table of the logic gates, so with a trainer kit. So how we can do the same experiments with the XSPICE hardware? So taken 7408 IC. It is a 14-pin 7408 IC. So there are four AND gates are there. This is the truth table for the AND gate. When both the inputs are high, I'm getting the output as high in the AND gate. I wanted to verify this. So in this, this is the 7408 IC which are connected to SQ1 and SQ2. They are the two inputs, and the output has taken at the pin number 3, and I have connected the ground and the fastest supply to pin number 14 and pin number 17 here. So the same experiments can be demonstrated with the help of two diodes. So here, these yellow color and the green color squares are the two inputs. So when both the inputs are high, so we are able to see output is high. If any one of the input is low or high, our output will be low. So this is how we can able to verify the truth table. So when both the inputs are high, our output will be high. In any one of the input or the output is high or low, our output will be low. So these experiments I am going to demonstrate in front of you. That is the off-way rectifier. So in the off-way rectifier, what will happen if I take a diode? We know that diode will allow current only in one direction. Now I'm supplying an AC signal to a diode, input diode, so that in the other end of the diode, I can able to see only the positive side of the or any one side of the signal. So that, let me make the connection and demonstrate it for you. I've taken a diode. I've taken a diode here. And the diode is connected in series with the resistor. To the one end of the diode, I am connecting a waveform generator that is giving the AC signal. The other end of the resistor is connected to ground, so that the circuit will be complete. But I wanted to see what is the input and the output. So that for the input, WGM connecting the A1, that is the measurement point, it is measuring the AC signal frequency in the input side. I'm connecting A2 to after the diode. I made the connection. So let me open the software and let me see how the waveform will be coming after the diode. I've chosen the off-way rectifier. Here you can see that I enabled only A1. Now if I enable A2, so it clearly shows that how the negative portion of the waveform is clipped. So this is the demonstration for the off-way rectifier. But what extra things we can do it here, if I connect a capacitor across the resistor, we can able to see that how the ripples are going to reduce. I just connected a 0.1 microfarad capacitance. If I change the capacitance value, if I increase the capacitance value with a larger capacitance value, you can see that. So how the AC signal is going to be a DC signal. So this will help us to help the students to understand the concepts better. So this is the screenshot of the previous experiment, that is the off-way rectifier. So not only the graphical user interface, the same experiments can be executed with Python code. So the small Python code which is written here, so that is executed, and the output also you can clearly see that. So here what I have done here, the input wave frequency, that is the 100 Hz, I am giving it. So with the sample numbers are 500 and with a sample duration of about 50 microseconds. So these are all the scale for x-axis, and this is for the scale for the y-axis, and this code is to just differentiate the colors of two frequencies. So this is the main concept I wanted to discuss here, that is the oscillations concept. Here there are two types of oscillations I wanted to discuss here. One is the mechanical oscillations, another is the electrical oscillations. So those mechanical oscillations are produced using a simple pendulum, and the electrical oscillations are produced using a electronic or electrical component such as inductor, capacitor and the resistor. So what are the learning objectives? So here students, this able to get experimental skills, here building the circuit, data collection, programming and interfacing the hardware to a computer, and by doing graphical and analytical analysis we can able to understand the concepts better. This experiment also I am not going to demonstrate it, but I have done the experiment here. This is an example for simple pendulum. What I have done here, I connected a ball to the DC motor. So the other end of the DC motor which is connected to a X-Y device. So if I take the ball to the experiment and I leave it from the experiment, so it will be oscillating through a mean position. So whatever the oscillation is producing with respect to that, EMF will be produced in the DC motor. That EMF is recorded on the screen. So you know that how the amplitude of voltage is reducing with respect to time. So that can be demonstrated here. So that even the mechanical oscillations can be recorded here. So this is the experiment for that experimental connection. So this is the DC motor which is connected to a pendulum. So by oscillating this pendulum, so the EMF which is produced, that is recorded at A3. Since the voltage is very feeble, I wanted to amplify that. That's why I am connecting 100 ohm resistor to a feedback resistor. That's why I am able to increase the signal here. Now this is the expression for the displacement, that is exponential of minus gamma into 2, that is the damping factor. So with respect to the damping factor, how the amplitude is keep on decreases with respect to time. So that by clicking on this analyze loss flash button, you can able to see what is the damping coefficient also. So that is related to X-Piles. Hardware can be utilized to demonstrate the simple pendulum experiment. For example, if I do the same experiments in the conventional way, here what we have to do it here, we have to record the experimental video that has to be uploaded to a Tracker Video Analyzer. It is a free video analysis and modeling tool built on the open source physics Java framework. So it is designed to use in physics education. So that, let me open the Tracker Video Analyzer software. So I have taken a video and just uploaded it into the tracking software. So what it is doing here, each frame which is looking for a specific location, I have selected this point. This is the bob attached to the spring. So in each frame it is locating this bob with respect to time. So for example, if I play a video, you can see that how the position of the bob which is recording with respect to time. So that is traced and all the data which are recorded here. I wanted to see that, I wanted to analyze this waveform. Let me double click on this. Now you can see that we got a clear sinusoidal waveform. I wanted to analyze this waveform. So we can do statistical analysis, Fourier spectrum and also the curve fitting. So this is suitable for a sinusoidal fitting, but slightly damped oscillations also. That's why I wanted to verify for the damped oscillations equations. Let me take the damped oscillations equations. So that is y is equal to exponential of minus bx into a sine of bx plus c. This is the damped harmonic oscillator differential equation. You can see that here there is a small variation. So because the damping coefficient is zero, that's why it is not exactly fitted on the experimental curve. If I select the auto fit options, you can see that how this automatically fitted onto the experimental curve. For example, if I make it zero, you can able to see that so this is the theoretical curve which is not fitting exactly with the experimental points. If I do the auto fit, so it is exactly fitting. And what is the damping coefficient? That is 0.03. So this is how we can do some of the graphical and the analytical analysis with the help of these open source tools. They are the mechanical oscillations that I demonstrated. Now I am going to LCR circuit. Here the oscillations which are produced using electrical components. So one is the LC circuit. So it is able to produce the simple harmonic oscillations. We wanted to verify two things here. One is heavily damped oscillations, another is low damped oscillations. So in the X-ray steel, I have taken so 120 ton coil. So it works as an inductor here, then the small capacitance. So what I am doing here, OD1, that is the digital output 1. So I wanted to connect an inductor to a digital output 1. Let me show you the experimental connections here. So I taken inductance coil here, the one end of the inductor which is connected to OD1, that is the digital output 1, and the other end is connected to A1. Okay, then I am taking a small value of capacitance. The one end of the capacitor is connected to A1, that is the common terminal for both inductor and the capacitor. The other end of the capacitor is connected to ground. Now let me open the software framework. So here there is an example for RLC transient response. If I supply a voltage from 0 to 5 volts, I am going to increase the time base here. If I supply a voltage between 0 to 5 volt, we can see that how the electrical components such as inductor and the capacitor is able to produce the oscillations. So it is an example for underdamped oscillations. So the amplitude of oscillation is decreasing with respect to time. If I change the capacitance value, if I use the higher value of capacitance, so let me see what will happen. I just used the 1 microfarad capacitor here. You can see that without oscillations, okay, so it is just coming to its mean position. So that you can verify that. So what are the heavily damped oscillations, then what are the underdamped oscillations? So this is how with the different values of capacitor and the inductor, we can able to get different types of oscillations, whether it is heavily damped oscillations or underdamped oscillations, so that can be demonstrated. Now this is an example of study of series of RC circuit. So here the capacitor and the resistor which is connected to AC source, that is WG, waveform generator. Now for a particular value of frequency, so the voltage along the x-axis and voltage along the y-axis, when both are equal, okay, so then you are able to see the circular ring here. So this is just the demonstration of this experiment. If you plot a voltage in both x and y axis, so this is a very known experiment, RC circuit, that is the charging and discharging of a capacitor. So here we are charging the capacitor or discharging the capacitor through a resistor R. So what will happen when you charge and discharge the capacitor? When it is connected to AC source, here I connected to square wave generator 1. So the green color one is the input signal. So the green color one is the output signal. So how the charging, in the charging mode, how the capacitance is charging exponentially and it is taking time, and when it gets saturated and it is discharging exponentially. So the charging and discharging, it depends on the time constant, that is multiplication of R and C. So that can be demonstrated here. So these are the experiments I'm going to demonstrate in front of you, that is the RLC circuits, how we can able to verify the resonance condition. It's a very well known experiment in the undergraduate level. So how can you produce the electrical oscillations and how can you verify the resonance condition? So here in this circuit connection, we are connecting the capacitor and the resistor to waveform generator. And here the inductor and the resistor which are connected to the waveform generator, and both these we can able to produce the oscillations. What will happen if I connect all the three, that is capacitor, inductor and the resistor, all are connected in series and are connected to waveform generator, that is the AC source. This is the conventional diagram of the LCR series circuit. I wanted to measure what is the voltage across each component. So let me demonstrate this experiment have taken a capacitor. To this capacitor, I am connecting a 10 microfarad inductor. In series with, I am connecting so 1 kilo ohm resistor. All three components are connected in series. I need to supply an AC signal. That's why I'm connecting a wire from WG to capacitor, so that the capacitor is connected to AC source. Then the resistor end is connected to ground. Now the circuit is closed, but I wanted to measure what is the voltage across each component, such that I wanted to connect a A1 terminal to a capacitor and A2 terminal that is between inductor and the resistor, and A3 is connected to that is between the capacitor and the inductor. So I made the circuit connection. I want to see what is the response. So this is an example of RLC steady state response. Here you can able to see that what is the voltage across each waveform is the supplied frequency, and blue color one is the voltage across the resistor, and the red one is voltage across both inductor and the capacitor. I'm just wanted to see what is the voltage across inductor and the capacitor separately. That's why I enabled show VL and VC. Now we can see that, so how the voltage is lagging. So here I'm just increasing the frequency. So at a particular frequency, you can see that how the phase difference is going to change here. This is the phasor diagram. So this will help us to so whether the voltage is lagging or the leading. So with increase in frequency, at particular frequency, at resonant frequency, at resonant frequency, we can say that the phase difference will be zero. It is exactly on the line. So voltage across the resistor will be more. Means it will be almost equal to the supplied voltage, means the supplied frequency. But what is the voltage across the capacitor and the inductor? They are very minimum. So when capacitive inductance and the inductive capacitance and the capacitive reactance and the inductive reactance both are equal, so our resistance value will be equal to impedance. So you can see that how impedance is equal to a resistance when XL is equal to XC, that is the capacitive reactance and the inductive reactance, and the phase difference is zero. So we can able to calculate what is the XL value, XC value, and the resonance frequency. So this is very useful experiment. With this we can see that how we can match the frequency of a transmitter and the frequency of the receiver can be matched. So this is widely used in communication system. So where you want to match the frequencies, okay, widely used in radios and televisions to match the frequencies. These experiments I wanted to demonstrate in the conventional way what we are doing in our laboratory. I wanted to close this terminal. So let me open the command mode. So just open the command mode. You can see that. So these are the experiments which are listed under physics. So these experiments are customized by our students. Since it is a open source platform, so we can able to customize the hardware as well as the software. So these are the experiments which are customized for our convenience. So let me open the series LCR circuit. So what I am doing here, let me show you the circuit connection in front of you. I'm just connecting a capacitor as usual. The capacitor, inductor, and the resistor which are connected in series. This one is the red one is the capacitor. That is 474 nanofarad capacitor that is connected to an inductor. This one is the inductor choke that is used in tube lights. It is a 1 Henry choke. So the inductor which is connected in series with the resistor, the resistance and directly other end of the resistor is connecting directly to a ground. So what I did here, I connected a capacitor, the inductor, and the resistor which is connected in series. And you can able to see the resistance box also. This is the resistance box. Conventionally, we are using this resistance box in our physics laboratory. Okay. Now the capacitor is connected to a waveform generator and A1 is connected to capacitor and the waveform generator common terminal, and A2 is connected to the terminal between resistor and the inductor. So this is the software framework which is customized for our convenience. So here I am going to change the frequency from 1 Hz to 500 Hz. So I can change to up to 5 kHz. In the resistance box, I am unplugging 1 ohm resistance. That's why I selected 1 ohm here. This frequency interval. So in what intervals the frequency should be changed? I am deciding it here. Maybe 1 to 500 Hz, I just divided it into 50 steps. I'm selecting what is the peak to peak voltage of the input signal. I'm selecting as a 3 volt. Now, I wanted to change the frequency along the x axis. I wanted to record what is the current with respect to this frequency on the y axis. So, if I start the button, the frequency will be varied from 1 Hz to 500 Hz in 500 steps. So, this is how I can able to get the response. So at the resonant condition, we can able to see what is the maximum current. So let me expand this waveform. So here I can able to see the maximum current is obtained at the resonant condition. For example, if I use instead of 1 ohm, if I use a 50 ohm resistance, then what will happen? So with increasing frequency, we can see that how the amplitude of the current is decreasing with respect to increasing the resistance here. So that at higher resistance, the amplitude is decreasing, but the resonant condition, at the resonant condition, so we are able to get a resonant at resonant frequency. So the amplitude is decreasing with the change in the resistance value, but the current, maximum current value, so we are able to get at the resonant condition. I wanted to save this data, then I wanted to record this data and wanted to replot it using another open source graph plotting software that is called Gnuplot. So here, what are the important things can also be learned here means, for example, instead of 50 steps, if I use only 25 steps, so how the car will be? So it will be very short, so that we can do multiple, means students can able to understand multiple things here by changing the amplitude, by changing the frequency steps, by changing the resistance value. So students can able to understand the concepts better here. So this is how, this is the software, the GUI, graphical user interface of the LCR series circuit. So I change the resistance value with different intervals. I can able to see that how the amplitude is keep on decreases with respect to resistance here. So, and also the peak is shifting towards the left hand side. So amplitude is decreasing with increase in resistance value, and the peak is shifting towards the left hand side. So these are all the things can be understandable with the help of this experiment. So the same data is extracted and plotted using a GNU plot, that is the open source graph plotting software. We can see that with the increase in resistance, how the amplitude can decrease, and also we can able to do some I just did the normal distribution fit here, so it is quite better. Now with the hardware, with this hardware, so we can plug our own trigonometric equations, so that can be connected to, means we can write our own Python code. So in this fashion, so that Python code can be integrated into your hardware, and we can able to see what is the output waveform. If you do the Fourier analysis, we can able to see, so for each individual frequency we can able to see the peaks here. So similar to that hardware and the software framework which we used now, so this can also be done in the similar fashion. So here I'm going to use the Scilab simulation. So in the Scilab simulation, so the Scilab, which is similar to a MATLAB, so here I'm going to do some of the simulations related to harmonic oscillator. So here this diagram is an example for simple harmonic oscillator, and this is an example of a damped harmonic oscillator. So here I'm choosing omega is equal to 2 pi f. Okay, f I just choose the 1 hertz here, that's why with 1 hertz I'm able to get the signal like this. So along with the omega, that is the natural frequency, I'm just adding a damping factor, that's how with increasing damping factor, or by adding the damping factor, how the amplitude of the signal is varying with respect to time. So that can be demonstrated. So let me open the Scilab framework. So if I execute this simulation, so how the waveform will be generated? So this is an example for simple harmonic oscillations. So here I am able to see the amplitude of oscillation is uniform throughout the time, so that it is an example for simple harmonic oscillations, so that these oscillations are generated, so with the help of this trigonometric relation. So here you can able to see that this differential equation, okay, second order differential equation, by plugging into a simulation, how we can able to see that simple harmonic oscillations. So if I open the damped harmonic oscillations simulations, if I open a damped harmonic oscillation simulations here, so along with the natural frequency, I'm just added a damped harmonic factor also here. So if I, by adding a damping factor, so if I run the simulation here, I can able to see that by adding a damping factor, how the amplitude of oscillation is decreasing with respect to time. So these are the conclusions of my presentation. It expands the education experiences through inquiry based approach. So we have a flexibility to change the physical parameters. So this will make us to understand the concepts better. And also there will be a repeatability, rapid and dynamic data display, and the immediate feedback. So through this interactive teaching aid, it has a great potential benefit and deepens the conceptual understanding in terms of multiple representation. So as already shown, the graphical and the numerical analysis. These are all the references of my presentation.